I want to talk about timeline for all of this. What's going to happen? Because the predictions we've been getting from our elected officials have been a little unreliable.
When you have 15 people, and the 15 within a couple of days is going to be down to close to zero, that's a pretty good job we've done.
That was February 26. There were 60 cases in the U.S. by then, not 15, and it didn't go to zero. They went to 4,663 as of March 17. Where are the numbers going next? Up or down? Let's take a look at the history of this thing. First case of coronavirus surfaced in China mid-November. By late December, Chinese doctors were trying to sound the alarm. Something unusual was going on. But, as we all know, initially the authorities shut them down and tried to keep the whole thing under wraps. Wuhan went into lockdown on January 23, roughly a month after doctors tried to blow the whistle. By then, there were 830 cases. Now, the incubation period varies, from a couple of days to all the way to 27 days for some outliers. So we're talking average a couple weeks, give or take. And in fact, the quarantine in most airports and borders is 14 days. So, if the measures work, we should expect the number of new infections to start going down after about 2 weeks, roughly. This is new cases reported day by day in China. Here we are on January 23. Wuhan goes on lockdown, but new cases continue to pop up. That's expected, right? The virus was incubating in those people. 2 weeks of lockdown puts us on February 6. After that, it does start to come down. Couple odd days, but in general, the trend is a clear down ramp. From 3,000 new cases a day at the peak, to 40 cases a day recently. That's a massive drop. Okay, some people don't trust those numbers. Maybe they're not reporting them accurately. They want to look better for the international community. Who knows? In science, you always want to look at replication. So let's look at South Korea. In Korea, they never did a full lockdown. Instead, throughout February, there were massive campaigns of public education and containment. They were asking the population to work from home, and they started rolling out their extensive testing. About 250,000 Koreans have now been tested for coronavirus. By early March, we see the number of new infections start to go down. They're seeing very small numbers now. Now, these are not like the experiments I'm used to doing in a lab where you control every little factor. There's a lot of variables here. We're looking at an entire country. But the trends suggest that these countries have turned the corner. Wait, maybe this is the normal course of the infection. Maybe the virus comes on for a couple weeks and then naturally dies off and goes away. Maybe all those measures have nothing to do with it. This is just the natural course. What we need is another example where things didn't go so textbook. Italy. After China, it's the country that's been hit the hardest. Let's look at Italy and Korea side by side. Unlike China, they have similar population size, 60 and 51 million. I replotted all the numbers day by day. Korea is orange. Coronavirus got there a little earlier. Not surprising, they're right next to China. Italy's about 3 days behind Korea. So Korea rose first, but by early March, Italy had caught up. Now remember, throughout February, Korea's clamping down hard. Social education, people are staying at home, getting tested. By early March, their numbers are going down. Italy keeps rising. Italy finally sets the nationwide quarantine on March 9. By then, they're averaging almost 2,000 new cases a day, twice what Korea was averaging at their peak. And Italian cases kept rising. They're currently averaging 3,500 new cases a day. That's the same China was averaging at their peak, with a much larger population, of course. Okay, the numbers kept rising even after Italy instituted the quarantine. Does that mean it's not working? No, it's expected. It's been about 10 days of quarantine now. So if it's like in Asia, this may start to round down sometime this week. Now, of course, there are many differences between the two countries, societal and otherwise. Italians are touchier. Italians may be more gregarious, they may go out more. That may all play a role. But the point here is we have two countries of similar population size that got hit at around the same time, and yet vastly different outcome. And I love Italy, it's one of my favorite countries in the world, and I love Italian people, and it really hurts me to see this, but all we can do is learn from it. France and Spain are also hurting. Both instituted a lockdown this week, borders closed, still trending up. Entirely expected. Okay, what about the US? Clearly trending up. Now, the US government has started to change its attitude recently. New guidelines came out this week recommending closing schools and avoiding non-essential travel, not going to bars and restaurants, etc. So, all societal and geographical differences notwithstanding, if the virus behaves in the West as it did in the Far East, we're looking at a couple weeks until we pass that peak and the numbers start going down, and then probably another couple weeks till the numbers get really low.
things are going to get worse before they get better.
Also worth noting, we don't know what happens after the lockdowns get lifted and people go back to their normal lives. It's possible we'll see another little uptick, but even if we do, it'll probably be much, much smaller than what we're seeing now, and we'll be much better prepared. So we have a model to follow. We can try to replicate the Korean case or the Italian. This is doable and we can make it happen, but it's going to take laying low for a while. It's a drag, I get that, but it will keep the number of deaths in the at-risk group as low as possible. In the meantime, we're going to figure out a lot about this virus and how to deal with it. These are the scientific studies on coronavirus published over the last 3 days. The pace of publication has been insane. I can tell you from personal experience, it normally takes months, sometimes even years, to get a paper peer-reviewed and accepted and published and out and available for reading. This turnover is unreal. They're probably fast-tracking these papers on coronavirus like crazy. Clinical trials ongoing all over the world looking at possible therapies. And some vaccines are already in phase one of testing. This virus is a couple of months old. I've never seen this speed of development in my entire life. And it's just to show you that the scientific community is not gonna take this lying down. Science is the most powerful thing we came up with as a species. And this is the time to put politics and ideology to the side and let science and public health do the work. Which is another reason that containing the spread is a great strategy. This whole idea of flattening the curve. Even if I do end up getting infected, having it now or 6 months or a year from now is probably gonna make a huge difference in terms of resources, knowledge, and experience. The only vaccine we have right now is high quality information, and I'll do my part to keep sharing it with everybody. So stay positive. We're gonna figure this one out, and I'll see you soon. If you thought that video was useful, consider sharing with others who might be interested, and hit that like button and subscribe for more Nutrition Made Simple. Also, feel free to link up with me on my Facebook page and on Twitter for more in-depth nutrition science.